This is Bonanza Creek in northwest Canada. On this spot in 1896, three wandering prospectors found gold lying in the rocks as thick as cheese in a sandwich. Between them, they started what became the maddest stampede in history, the Klondike Gold Rush. There was only one realistic way to reach the goldfields. You had to walk from the coast of Alaska, starting at the tiny port of Skagway. Skagway soon became the roughest, the most lawless town in America, which in those days was saying a great deal. A visiting Mountie thought it was little better than hell on earth. Many of the stampeders, often unemployed clerks and farm boys who'd never left home before, got no further than Skagway. They lost their life savings to the con men, the thieves, tarts, and the showgirls who infested the place. Nowadays, impeccably virtuous, middle-class high school students wear the costumes of the 1890s to impress the modern stampeder, the tourist. And this is the reason why tourists still pour into Skagway, to ride on the White Pass and Yukon Railway. It was built for the gold rush with Irish expertise and British money, which is perhaps why it was completed just as the gold rush ended 2 years later. Today, it's still a real working railway, carrying vitally needed tourists, food and fuel into the Yukon and bringing the Yukon's vast mineral wealth back out. You still see the occasional gold miner riding in these splendid old-fashioned parlor cars, which no one has had the heart, or come to that, the money, to replace. Every day in summer, a train backs down the streets of Skagway to pick up the daily delivery of tourists. If they're lucky, it's pulled by refurbished steam engine number 73. Which has been with the White Pass since it left Baldwin's Philadelphia workshops in 1947. It's dawn and the tourists climb from their boats to run a gauntlet of packaged welcomes. They're met by someone that we'd call a ticket collector, but here is known as a passenger services representative, Steve Heights.
Klondike Holidays, welcome to Skagway and the White Pass Railroad.
Hey, take a look at your tickets, please.
I don't have a ticket.
All right. Skagway Whitehorse. Smoking or no smoking this morning?
No smoking.
No smoking in car 268 right here. Right on.
Which right.
Engines, they're up there foraging for food.
Oh, right.
Now, car
268
right there.
Yes.
Right, big smile. Oh, ready, there we go. Okay, thank you. Right, here we go. Ready, there you go. Thank you. And my next little lady's smiling. Okay, there we go, darling. Big smile, though. Here we go. Ready, there you go. Thank you. Wake up. Here we go. Ready. Okay.
Hello.
Hello.
Thank you.
Is that a smoking car?
If you would like to smoke, car 256 is a smoker.
Okay.
They're going to provide the same service.
These fellas here will check your bags and where are you traveling? All the way through to Whitehorse?
Yes. Yeah.
Most of the travelers are elderly Americans who are taking the last big package tour of their lives. Now and again, the trip will come to a halt to offer them photo opportunities of some of the most desolate and beautiful land left in the world. The railway, though not always its management, inspires tremendous loyalty from its employees. Beneath his Doctor Who costume, Steve Heitz may be its greatest fan.
It is so unique and so special. It's the last one of its kind. But when I first come into Skagway and got off the ferry and saw that little track there, I said, this is it. Man, this is Colorado in 1958. And it's you know, 20 years after the fact. And you got a chance here to see that it's still running. It's still doing what it was built to do. This is no candy-coated dance hall dream. Every ride on this railroad is an adventure. It's the last one of its kind left here. I mean, this thing is not Disneyland. This is the real McCoy. There's no audio animatronics bears along the side of the track that go rawr, rawr, rawr when you punch a button and the train goes. Those are real 1,000-foot cliffs that you're along the side of. That those steel cantilever bridges and those tunnels and those cliffs above you are the same ones that Mike Heaney and all those contractors and survey boys were hanging off of with ropes when they blasted the whole thing along the side of the cliff.
Mike Heaney was called the Irish Prince and was one of the most celebrated railway engineers of his day. To do the blasting, he recruited failed stampeders, the ones who'd finally run out of money and hope. There's never been such a highly educated gang of navvies. There were doctors, lawyers, Parisian chefs, at least one Oxford Don. Every profession, it was said, except labourer. When rumours of another gold strike reached the line, almost all the workforce ran off, taking the railway's shovels and picks with them. Running a railway through this sort of terrain still means a constant battle against the weather and against mechanical breakdown. Losing steam on one of the steepest gradients in the world calls for desperate measures.
Had a bolt or something.
You know, if you didn't have a piece of rubber or anything,
we got a
pick. I got it.
We got it. We got to have a bolt or something. Just put it inside the pick and roll it in.
He's getting one.
I got one.
Thank you.
The train winds up through the St. Elias Mountains, following the Stampeders' route on the awesome White Pass Trail, a 20-mile climb that can be crippling and freezing. In those days, people swore that they could see pack animals commit suicide by stepping over the cliffs, rather than walk another step with the burdens they were carrying. Of all the creatures on the trail, only the animals were not driven forward by the desperate yearning for gold. That yearning took the Stampeders over 40 miles of frozen mountains from the Alaskan coast to Lake Bennett in Canada, where they could take to water. The walk was frightful enough to do once, but there was another catch as well. The Mounties insisted that every prospector must cross the Canadian border with a ton of supplies, about a year's worth. And that meant 20 to 30 grueling journeys to carry the food and equipment up over the pass. So throughout the winter of 1898, there was an endless, slow human chain toiling up the mountains. If you left the queue to take a rest, you could wait several hours to get back in again. The doyen of the White Pass Engineers, or Hogheads as they like to call themselves, is J.D. True. He's been in many spectacular crashes and likes to recount them with loving attention to detail.
Well, in 1965, I was running a mixed extra. Had passengers on the rear and freight train. I had two engines, 95 and 93. And up just this side of Clifton, I come around the curve and the field under the track was gone. The engine went down into a rock wall and tumbled down the mountainside. The rear engine, it went clear into the river 1,000 feet below, and the one I was on stopped on a ledge about 250 feet down. 8 cars of ore went in with us. I shan't forget that. I got a broken pelvis out of it, and I laid in the hospital most of that summer. But I couldn't wait to get back on an engine.
Engineer True has had a long affair with number 73. He was the last man to drive it when it was still in regular service. And since then, it's figured a lot in his thoughts.
It's a dream come true, I would say. When we hauled it over to Bennett to put it on display a few years ago, I thought that was the end of it. I thought it would sit there till it rusted away. Even when they took it away 11 or 12 years later over to Whitehorse, I never thought that they would rebuild it. I thought it was just a pipe dream. And I still can't believe it.
Almost nobody lives along the track. Here the maps show the old gold rush city of Log Cabin. Now just two buildings remain, downtown Log Cabin and suburban Log Cabin. Miles up the line is Bennett, the lakehead where the prospectors stopped to build boats so they could float the remaining 500 miles to the gold fields. One winter, this was a tent city of 20,000 people, all waiting for the ice to break. The train is now the only way in and the only way out of Bennett, and the small cluster of buildings left behind exists solely to serve the railway passengers their lunch.
Could I have your attention, please? Welcome to Bennett. If you're with a partner, please come in together. Everything is hot and on the table. Just help yourself. Please listen to the waiter that is seating you. Thank you.
The tourists grab a hold of their eaten irons, or at least their eaten plastics, and start shoveling down moose stew and beans of a kind which brook no argument. Actually, it isn't always moose, though plenty of that does get eaten in the Yukon. Nowadays, it's easier for the railway to ship beef in from Chicago than to send one of the men out to kill the diminishing local wildlife.
We have enough for you.
Yeah.
We certainly don't want you to run out of lunch out here in the middle of nowhere. They figure they can get about 900 to 1,000 people that can eat it
every day. That's an awful lot of beans.
That's right. The other train's coming in just a minute, too. You'll hear it come roaring by.
Could I have your attention, please? I would like to ask you all to remain seated until we seat the other train. Thank you.
This was a city of 20,000 people during the Gold Rush. Back in the good
old days. 20,000?
20,000 people
here
during the Klondike. All along the lake's edge, all of this waterfront here was all tents. Guys building boats. The gold is still another 450, 500 miles north of here to Dawson.
This is Dawson City, the center of the Klondike. 35,000 people lived here at the height of the Gold Rush, and it was the biggest city west of Winnipeg. Now, fewer than 1,000 live here all year round. Some of the old buildings are being nursed by the Canadian government. Others are collapsing gently back into the mud and the dirt. There are still miners here, come to see what can be scratched from the old claims, or to find if they can strike a whole new seam of gold. There are young people who years ago used to be called hippies, who are attracted by the placid and nostalgic melancholy of the place. A few of them stay on, but not many visitors can stand the winter cold, and each October the inhabitants huddle in again, content to be left by themselves. Around the gold-bearing creeks of the River Klondike, Hunker, Bonanza, El Dorado, the big companies moved in and bought up all the old single prospectors' claims. Over the years, the companies have ripped down the hillsides and passed them through giant dredges, swilling out the last few ounces of gold from each ton of rock and soil. But in spite of these vast modern operations, there's still only one practical way to find gold. It means one man trudging from place to place with nothing more sophisticated than a black-bottomed pan.
Now, if you're gold panning, you depend on the fact that gold is 8 times as heavy as rock. So you want to mix up all the material that's in your pan into a soup. Any big rocks in there, you wash them off in your own water, then you can pitch them. You want to get all your material loose and moving inside your pan. Now, when it's at the consistency of quicksand, then the gold and the heavy material has a chance to sink through that material and get collected down on the bottom of your pan. In essence, what you're doing is just duplicating nature.
Michael Laforet is a gnarled and grizzled old public relations man who gave up life in the soft south of Canada to come prospecting in the Yukon, and he now lives on top of his own gold mine. He adopted the name Black Mike along with the approved amount of gnarled and grizzled facial hair.
Your material down to this stage, what you end up with is the black sand and the light sand and the gold. So the way to get it off is to dry out your material first of all, carefully out of your pan. And then use a magnet. The black sand is mostly magnetite. It's an iron base, so it reacts to a magnet. You always work your magnet from below and pull up on an angle so that any gold contained with the black sand will fall back. Then you cover up your magnet with a napkin, and all of a sudden the black sand just jumps up, just like magic. In no time do my fingers ever leave my hand. Now, once you've got your black sand off, then you've just got light sand and gold in here. You can put it all into another plate and then blow it off. Now, when you've blown the gold down to this stage, you've got most of the sand off it, then you can take an ordinary screen and pass all your material through the screen, and what remains on the screen is your jewelry-sized nuggets. It's the same as anything. It's a living. I just happen to enjoy gold mining, and it's one way of making a living, and it's a very profitable way in some cases. Of course, everybody has a right to go broke, but and gold miners sometimes take that right. There are no guarantees. In many cases, it'd be a lot easier to take a paycheck job, and there's a paycheck for you every 2 weeks. But with gold mining, you have no guarantees, and the earth doesn't give receipts. So the tax man doesn't know about anything. I'm able to wrest my living out of the ground by the sweat of my brow, and then put it in my pocket and go sell it. And I run my own show and do what I want. And if I don't want to wake up in the morning, I just roll over. It's a nice lifestyle. So that's probably what keeps me here. The gold's just secondary.
Back at Bennett, and the tourists digest their stew with a walk up to the church. This was finished just as the ice broke and the stampeders all departed. No one has ever preached a sermon there. At Bennett, the railway begins to change its character. A modern diesel takes over for the rest of the journey to Whitehorse. Steve Heights gathers together just some of his flock. The rest are going back to Skagway.
Are there any more for Whitehorse?
That's it. That's all.
As the train heads north, the acrid smell of the stoves combines with the powerful magic of the beans to create a uniquely distinctive fug. By this stage of the trip, there are fewer tourists, more of the local people who depend on the railway for their livelihood. The train rolls through the only rail settlement on the whole route, Caribou Crossing, which is now known as Carcross. The two ends of the line met here in 1900, and the traditional ceremony of the golden spike was performed. Performed very badly, because the many visiting dignitaries had spent the entire morning getting drunk in the Caribou Hotel, 10 yards from the track. In autumn, the Yukon is beautiful, tractable, and temperate. But keeping an 85-year-old railbed in operation through a subarctic winter is a much harder proposition.
Well, I don't know. The coldest I worked on the railroad was about 55 below. But then after that, we generally didn't go out if we didn't have to. There wasn't something wrong. We were out over 50 below last year. You just don't feel like moving sometimes. You just get so stiff and just don't feel like going.
Life is always hard and demanding in the Yukon, but it's particularly harsh now. The world recession has brought the closure of the territory's biggest mines, which sent lead, zinc and copper to Germany and Japan. And without any ore to carry, the White Pass Railway has had to close down this winter for the first time in its history. It's always been a boom and bust economy here. A boom 2 years ago when the price of gold touched $1,000 an ounce, and there was a boom when they built the Alaska Highway. But now there's a bust, and it's brought fears that thousands of people might go south and leave the territory forever. The railway runs by the Yukon River, where the thousands of prospectors risk their lives and their equipment on the rocks and the rapids in their shakily built boats. In the end, the same driving Victorian energy which got the railway constructed also built vast stern wheelers like the SS Klondike, now beached as a museum piece in the train's final destination, Whitehorse. Whitehorse is a friendly, bustling North American small town plonked down in the middle of the Canadian wilderness. The Yukon is bigger than the whole United Kingdom, West Germany and Holland put together, yet it has roughly the same population as Bury St. Edmunds. In this whole vast territory, there are a grand total of 5 traffic lights, all of them in Whitehorse. People here will tell you they have social problems. The Indians, who are about a third of the Yukon's population, usually get the dirty end of whichever stick is going. And of course, they're the slowest to get new jobs when employment is hard to come by. They also have a drink problem. Almost all the crime here is committed by Indians when drunk. And of course, there are race problems too, yet compared to Detroit or Miami or even the middle of London, the people here manage to live in neighborly friendship. Even the Ku Klux Klan was quickly run out of town when it tried to set up in Whitehorse.
Hello.
There is one train a day in each direction, and as winter approaches in early September, the diesels drag out the flatbeds, loaded with the last effects of people fleeing from the invading cold. The almost empty parlour cars rattle home to Skagway. It takes an unusual kind of person to want to come to the Yukon and to stay. Robert Service, a bank clerk from Preston, Lancashire, who became a much-loved writer of doggerel verse, lived in this cabin when he wrote The Shooting of Dan McGrew and The Spell of the Yukon. I wanted the gold and I sought it. I scrabbled and mucked like a slave. Was it famine or scurvy? I fought it. I hurled my youth into the grave. You come to get rich, damn good reason. You feel like an exile at first. You hate it like hell for a season, and then you are worse than the worst. Another Lancastrian, Alan Byram, ventured to the Yukon 16 years ago. He's just built his own cabin in the woods.
But survival is a part of being here, that element of mastering tools and mastering the environment. And quite a few people come here imagining that they will survive some great natural catastrophe. But to survive as the original people who lived here survived, you'd have to be incredibly fit to chase moose for hundreds of miles, etc. Plus a tremendous amount of skill. So you make a compromise between doing that, living like the first man, and taking part of the more luxurious things. You're tested to the limits here sometimes, in every conceivable way. Physically and psychologically, you're really put to a test. Surviving the winters is quite an incredible thing. There's points in the winter where you're actually reduced to almost nothing. It sort of strips you down. And in the spring, it is literally a rebirth. You reemerge much stronger, I think. A lot of people come here and they think they're going to stay here forever. They're going to die here, be eaten by crows. Then after two winters, they're gone to live somewhere else forever. It's a hard place to stick around. You have to be in debt.
There have always been people drawn to the Yukon, and they still have a lot in common with the gold stampeders of 80-odd years ago. A measure of greed, a longing to escape, a lot of romance. Above all, like their railway, they have a fierce ability simply to survive.
And it's always got to be remembered that as goes the Yukon, so goes the railway. The ups and downs of economics in Skagway or in White Horse or in along the railway itself or the entire Yukon territory are nothing new. It's just something which occasionally seems to happen and move through the times. The railroad is a very tenacious operation. People in Skagway and in White Horse have gotten very used to, operating with a baling wire technique. Back when we don't have any parts, so we don't know how to put something together. Well, fine. In the 1930s, we didn't have any money. You learn how to jerry-rig something together. And that kind of a mentality is a saving grace for this kind of a backwoods frontier operation where you're on the cutting edge of transport. You have to maintain the lifelines. You've got to keep the railroad open.